Onto the show. Alchemy Radio. Today's guest is Tobias Churton. Tobias is a leading authority on Gnostic spirituality. He holds a master's degree in theology and was appointed honorary fellow and faculty lecturer in Western Esotericism at Exeter University in 2005. Tobias is also a filmmaker, a poet, composer, and the author of many books, including The Gnostics, Gnostic Philosophy, The Babylon Gene, and Biographies of William Blake, and our primary focus for today, Aleister Crowley. Tobias, you're very welcome to Alchemy Radio. How are things?
I'm very well, thanks, and it's a delight to be with you.
Well, the delight is all mine, trust me. And we were speaking off air about devil's advocates and that kind of thing with regard to questioning and interviewing style. And I think it's quite apt because we will be talking about Aleister Crowley, who is a fascinating individual. And there are very few on God's green earth or Satan's green earth or whoever's green earth we want to talk about who know more about Aleister. But before we do that, I'd like to know a little bit about you, Tobias. So for those who aren't familiar with your work, there's a question I ask everybody who comes on the show. And that's, how did you get from where you were, and you can go as far back as you like, to where you are now?
What a impossible question. I was born deaf, so I had the pleasure of not hearing what the world had to say for the first 3 years of my life, and I think this marked me out.
I think it would have done.
And I've always been very open-minded to spiritual things ever since I can remember. And that sort of shaped the direction my life took. I wanted to be Archbishop of Canterbury and a film director when I was younger. Maybe both, or one or the other. But as it's turned out, I've done one and narrowly ruined my chances of the other.
And do you still aspire to the other?
No, you only have to look at the fools who are becoming Archbishop to realise I haven't missed much there. He doesn't
exactly
have much authority, but if I'd been in the position, perhaps I'd been able to do something with it. As for film director, I've decided that Orson Welles is simply impossible to beat, and that job has been done for me. So I'm sort of left with writing and music. And so my feeling is how to express the inexpressible. And that's what I've made in my life since leaving university, is to try and give form and meaning to the lost spiritual traditions of the Western world.
And it's brought you down a very interesting path, and quite a wide-ranging path as well, because you've written extensively on Gnosticism, which is a subject we would like to speak with you at length at a later date. But what was it that led you specifically down that path, and where does Aleister Crowley come into things?
When I was an undergraduate at Oxford in the late 70s, I had to do a routine theological essay on the Gnostics. And by the time I'd done that, I think I'd also heard about Aleister Crowley, because I used to go mountaineering. That was my hobby at the time, my late teens. And I went to, it was the Oxford Mountaineering Society. And somebody was talking about Chris Bonington's hero, this fellow Aleister Crowley, a noted climber. And on that basis, I took an interest. When a friend of mine gave me a copy of his Confessions, I was even more intrigued, because he was not only a climber, but also a mystic, and wrote very convincing and wonderful prose, I thought, about the whole issue of man in relation to invisible powers of the universe. And he put it in such a way that impressed the mind of a would-be philosopher who was looking for some spiritual meat, but expressed by somebody of great intellect. Very often, spiritual things tend to be the work of enthusiasts, whereas Crowley was an intellectual. So that impressed me. So when I came to write this essay on Gnosticism, I had already in my mind, I think, some idea that Gnosticism was not a historical artifact from the second century AD, as theology demanded I see it, as a heresy, but it was a kind of living tradition amongst peculiarly remarkable minds. And I've always been interested in original intellects, people who walk their own path intellectually, but have the ability to rationalize what they're experiencing. I thought Crowley was remarkable in this respect. So Crowley, Gnosticism, was sort of bound up. These are people I felt something in common with, and so I must have been a Gnostic from birth, I think. So you could say, well, in that case, Toby, you're not capable of objective analysis of this subject. You're too committed to it. And I can only say to that, well, I'm pretty well trained in objective analysis and self-criticism, and it's always been a struggle with this subject. It's not like I believe in it. It's for me, it's always been, I've been criticized by other Gnostics for being too rational about it. But I'm always try and put myself in the dock and challenge myself with the thoughts, is this right? Is this true? Does this work actually? Are you fooling yourself? Are you being fooled? So I think I'm in a pretty good position. I don't think you can understand anything unless you've experienced it.
Well, I think properly. So. I've found that in my own life. I mean, we can be told things until the cows come home, but it doesn't really sink in until we've gone through it.
That's right. I remember I was thinking about my own child first experiencing a death of a member of the family, and she just didn't know how to react, of course, as you don't when you're little. And it's only later when you somebody very close to you dies that you start to appreciate the sadness and all the rest of it. Mm. So, yes, I think experience of the heart is what counts. And then you think about it. It's a natural stage to think about things that happen to you. So all my interest really is thinking about things that have happened to myself and the broad culture out of which I've emerged.
And would you see Gnosticism almost as a decoding device then to, I suppose, put some kind of frame of reference on feelings or experiences?
Well, that's an interesting way of putting it. I remember thinking, when I first studied it officially and under the tutor's eye, that these people weren't doing what their enemies thought they were doing. They really weren't trying to construct a theology to challenge orthodoxy. They weren't that interested. I think Carl Jung, the psychologist, had quite a good idea when he saw their importance to psychology. They were, as I saw it, they were trying to draw a map of the mind and the way that the imagination operates with regard to spiritual experience. And so they weren't producing a sort of systematic, logical theology in the Catholic sense. When I think of the Catholic sense, I think of the tradition of Tertullian and the patristic fathers, which is very well represented at the Vatican, for example, today, where they tried to produce a sort of legalistic formulation of man, his place in the universe, and what's good for him. The Gnostics aren't going to that kind of authority. They're looking at their inner experiences of what it actually existentially feels to be alive in this world. Hans Jonas, another fine philosopher who I met in the 80s, long dead now, but was a great scholar of Gnosticism, and he saw them as the first existentialists. And I think all that chimes in with the kind of spiritual distress of our era, where authority in religion, legalistic presentations of religion, may have power over the simpler minds, but a large number of educated people have come about who are looking for a more, not only more rational system, but one which speaks to their experience. So I think Gnosticism comes alive in all of that. And promoting that awareness and encouraging it is part of the task of what I try to do, which is to make information available in the best way I can.
Let's go on to Aleister Crowley then, because he's a fascinating individual. For those who don't know anything about him, we'll go into that. But he has been dubbed, I suppose, the wickedest man in the world is what springs to mind whenever I hear Aleister Crowley mentioned. So, Tobias, who was Crowley? And give us a little bit about his background for those that don't know.
Aleister Crowley was a remarkable phenomenon of the late Victorian age. One can't imagine him emerging in any other period quite in the way he did. But at the same time, he wasn't really of his time at all in certain respects. He was terribly advanced in his humor and thinking. He would have found Monty Python perfectly acceptable entertainment. Might have thought he was a bit labored. I think he was a hell of a wit himself. He was brought up under the most strict Christian tutoring imaginable. He was a member of the exclusive Plymouth Brethren, which I think started in Dublin, actually, in about the 1830s under John Nelson Darby, and had spread to England with the doctrine that every word of the King James Bible is absolutely and literally true, and every single word can be applied to every situation a person finds themselves in. So that Crowley was immersed in biblical literalism to the extent that he wasn't allowed to play with other children who were not brethren children. And they had to be the right brethren children too, not just any Plymouth brother. They had to be part of the exclusive group. So these people thought of themselves as extraordinarily superior Christians and looked down on the Church of England, Catholics and everybody else's. I mean, they would have regarded today's fundamentalist biblical advocates from the sort of southern states in the popular image of that as woefully lax and bound for damnation. They weren't nearly fundamental enough. So Crowley had this repressive upbringing. But at the same time, his father was lived the life of a gentleman off his own money and investments. He didn't work for a living. He was upper class in his lifestyle and very free. And his father was a preacher, traveling preacher, who funded himself and funded preaching books. So Crowley had all this Christian upbringing. He knew the Bible really backwards, incredibly well. He could quote vast chunks of it in a way which would astonish people probably today. There aren't many people who with that facility today. But in his teen years, his father died when he was 12, if I remember right, 11 or 12. And he became dissatisfied with the way that the brethren had treated his father. They'd put him through a kind of wacky health routine, an electrical instrument. He was experimental in the way that sort of very much on the principle of sort of like this, what do you call the Christian scientists, you know, don't go to a straightforward doctor. Oh, no. All diseases can be cured by prayer and spiritual means, you know. Crowley took it that his father had been murdered by these people. And as he said in his hagiography, as he called it jokingly, he found himself sympathetic to what he called the enemies of heaven. And he found all the sort of dangerous characters of the Bible suddenly looked rather brilliant and interesting. Jezebel became a fascinating figure. The beast of the apocalypse. There's this whole, he starts to imaginatively identify himself with the idea of that this great repressive Christianity that he was brought up with was crumbling. And as he advanced intellectually, which his main interest was science at this time, actually, scientific subjects, biology, but particularly chemistry, he thought that science was just going to whack all this stuff way out of the field and be replaced by a sort of more rational humanistic faith. He discovered, as he said, cards and girls. That made a big impression on him. But when he was at university, he went to Cambridge, recommended by the Prime Minister, Lord Salisbury, and he was training to be a diplomat. And he had a spiritual crisis. Two things seemed to have happened. One was a depression that came over him when he asked, what is the meaning of life? What if he was the ambassador to some country or other, to St. Petersburg? What did this mean ultimately? Would he be known, remembered for anything he could do? And he started to see the world as the play of spiritual forces, and that the life worth living would have to be in consistency with spiritual forces. And at the same time as he realized that, he also had his first sort of serious homosexual experiences. And that changed him radically, because he got so turned on, literally. He began to see sex as a magical, transformative experience, and therefore could understand Victorian sex repression, which was represented by his mother. Anyway, all this is very theoretical. The fact of the matter is Crowley was a hell of a gas of a character, immense humor. He wrote pornographic stuff for a joke in the 1890s, had it published in the decadent style using Aubrey Beardsley's Dutch publisher. I mean, he just wanted, you know, he was an épaté les bourgeois character, belonged sort of very much in the 1960s, if you like, or the 20s, proto-surrealist. Let's wake up, let's wake society up. This was what he wanted to do. And he, as he put it at one point, he wanted to liberate the boys and girls of England. And he felt that they were under a great repressive blanket of repression that needed to be removed. And he saw himself, remarkably, as the man who might be the servant of the powers for the liberation of mankind. Now, this is where, of course, you get the problem, because Crowley is conceiving himself in a Gnostic, as a Gnostic liberator, which to all the mainstream churches can only mean one thing. It means he's not working for the God of the Christian church. He must be working for the other side.
Yeah.
And his first opposition came at Cambridge, from the Cambridge University Intercollegiate Christian Union. And they were the first people to sort of write against him. And that carried on all his life, and eventually creates this absurd mythology of him as a demonic character, as opposed to a daimonic character.
So the boys and girls of England didn't react too kindly to his aspirations and to his teachings.
No, I think when the boys and girls have been able to get his stuff, they love it. You know, that's true today more than then. At the time, he inherited a fortune and was publishing his own books, and those who read them very often became his followers, acolytes. And he basically invented a religion, Thelema. Wasn't an entire invention. It was a synthesis of what he thought was the best of the esoteric traditions.
Mm.
When people asked him about its meaning, he would quote St. Augustine, "Love and do what you will." That's Augustine, not Crowley.
And of course, that phrase has been, I suppose it's been regurgitated so many times, or bastardized nearly, that it has become associated with him basically saying, look, do whatever it is you want to do, to hell with the consequences, and be as evil and bad as you can. And that's not entirely the case, is it?
Well, this is, as he said as often as it needed to, why can't they see the difference? I never said do as thou wilt.
Mm.
It's do what thou wilt. There's a content of the true will. And of course, the original phrase comes from the Catholic doctor and former monk François Rabelais, fais ce qui, it's the old French, fais ce que voudras, do what you wilt, do what thou wilt, which was inscribed over the gate of the Abbey of Thelema in Gargantua and Pantagruel, in Rabelais' satirical novel. Crowley picks up on that idea, and so Rabelais becomes a priest of this spiritual freedom. If you read the account of the Thelemites in Rabelais, you get a very clear picture of what Thelema is all about. It's about people who've kind of grown up and just want to live a free, decent life, pursuing their proper goals in life, unhindered by stupid, judgmental, accusatory people around interfering. If you wanted to put the most vulgar meaning to Crowley's system, you would say it's mind your own business. And that is the goal of a life, is to find out what your business is and mind it. And that process of discovering your true will, or as Crowley once put in his diary in 1921, when I am doing God's will, he says, or as I call it, my true will. Now, that's very important, isn't it? He didn't like talk about God because he said you shouldn't use words you can't accurately define.
Hmm.
And I think that's a perfectly reasonable statement, since they're still arguing about the creeds today. People can't accurately define the word God. And so he said, my true will, by which he meant an elemental power in the human soul, which has its own orbit, its own destiny. So it's a romantic system. Now, we all want to believe, anyone who's seen Lawrence of Arabia with a heart is moved by the words, you know, Aqaba, when he suddenly realizes his moment in history has come and he has to play that part. It's certainly the kind of moment that motivates me and should motivate, I think, all young people who are born for a purpose, not to become wage slaves. That was the kind of society Crowley was absolutely against, was the great machine that he saw developing in the late 19th century England and being foisted on the empire of the great industrial machine. Now, that's what we have today. The world is made up of multinational companies which are dictating slowly but surely the form of education, news, and concepts of life that are appropriate for their trip into money-making heaven. And Crowley stands against that concept of life. He doesn't stand against people setting up companies and doing wonderful things, but it's the encroachment on the inner life of the individual, whether that comes from church, state, or whatever it is. He believed in the individual. He believed in man. That's what he stood for. And he was a magician in the sense that, say, Simon Magus, who was also lambasted in the Acts of the Apostles, he's a magician in the fullest sense, not a stage joker, but a mage. You know, the wise men who came to worship Jesus were the Magoi in Matthew's Gospel. Mm. Magi came to worship. And that was the tradition that he wanted to be part of. He wanted to revive magic, which you would say is a totally romantic and impossible thing. Magic has such a bad name. If you had any of the current scientific apostles on, from Stephen Dawkins to the guy who presents the programs about outer space and tries to make it all sound fantastic, you know, they would say magic is a remnant of our ignorant pre-scientific past, whereas anyone who knows the history of magic will understand that science as we know it is in fact a branch of magic. A bold statement and deeply unwelcome, I dare say, but I can't help it. That's history. You only got to find out what Isaac Newton was reading and obsessed with when he was doing his calculations on gravity. But they like the gravity, but they don't like the magic.
And that's the problem with a lot of modern science, and we touch on it quite a bit on this show with various guests and interviewees. Magic has become, and I think through the mainstream media and popular culture or whatever, it's become this something to be laughed at almost, or scoffed at, or discounted, when in fact the vast majority of modern science as we know it actually has its roots in magic. So could you define what you think magic is, or what Crowley thought magic was, as opposed to this image we have of, I don't know, a Disney cartoon and witches and wizards and the stereotypical magic that most kids are presented, and I suppose the stereotype that remains with most adults then because of the foundation as kids?
Well, Crowley defined magic in several ways. The most famous way, he said, it was the art and science of causing changes to occur in nature in accordance with will. So it's about the activation of the will. Mm. Now, the purpose of that is to do the true will. So it's simply about the ability to do. Pouvoir, as the French would say. Why, you know, the ability to do. That's what magic is. So it's quite universal. Now, there are departments of it and aspects of it, some which are, you know, today I don't suppose we'd hang spiders around our neck to cure ourselves of a sore throat like Elias Ashmole in the 17th century would. That would have been called magic. Most of the magic we have today we call technology and science. But there is an aspect of the higher magic was to do with the spiritual life, and that was the reserved area for the greatest practitioners. So, but all these levels of magic are get confused, and our problem is, as you've already indicated, that since the scientific revolution, 17th to 19th century, magic has been the baby thrown out with the bathwater, as we've emerged from medieval concepts of demonic powers, you know, forever trying to poke us with the tridents. So Crowley wanted to restore a grander and pre-Christian idea of magic as the great art of life. And so magic is, in order to do the magic that Crowley talks of, the highest form of magic, you have to ally it to mysticism, generally, as we call it, which is the discipline whereby you attain to spiritual states of mind. Then in that state of mind, you may do your magic, i.e. your will. I mean, he gives a lovely example that I want to impress somebody's mind. I want to get them to do something. I take my magical weapon. It's called a fountain pen. I use my magical medium, which is not ectoplasm. It's a piece of paper. I apply my thoughts to the pen. I make my wand do what I want on the paper. I put it in an envelope, send it to the appropriate recipient. And if you do it well and correctly, you will get a result. Now, that's the simplest idea I can say of magic. But there are other aspects, like the quality of activity. When we say something is magical, oh, that was a magical day. Mm. And I remember watching the Rolling Stones at Glastonbury the year before. Was it last year, wasn't it? and just thinking that is magical. Although my wife, who's actually there standing at the far back, couldn't hear it, so it wasn't very magical for her. But I was watching it in the comfort of televisual heaven, and it was very magical to me as I saw something of the old England suddenly light up as Michael Evis's face also lit up. Everyone felt that there was really some magic and some sympathy for the daimon, very much there. Mm. Great art has this magical quality. It's the ability to transform things to higher levels and to get to grips with them. So our whole culture is suffering from kind of loss of spirit, isn't it? It's Jim Morrison, wandering like souls forgot. Do you know we exist? Have you forgotten the keys to the kingdom? Have you been born yet, and are you alive? Let's reinvent the gods, all the myths of the ages, celebrate symbols from deep elder forests. You know, you have that in The Doors, who are picking up on William Blake's mode of re-entering the imaginative power of mankind, and humankind, as is more appropriate to say these days. And that's what we're about. We're about waking up the human being to his potential. Young people most certainly want to know about this sort of thing before they get swallowed up and the bars grow against the growing boy, as Wordsworth, you know, that the bonds, we get tied up, tied down, like the parable of the seed, you know. All that wonderful human potential, it gets thrown away, cast and wasted. And yet Crowley's the demon. But I see the spiritual wasteland of modern life as demonic I'm using that word in a purely sort of romantic or descriptive sense. I see, you know, whose is the kingdom of Satan? You know, where is this self egotistic monstrous world? Where's that? What's all that about? You know, we watch it on TV. We think it, therefore, it's separate from us. We can switch it off. But it's all about us. Our culture is going through amazing change. It may be that Crowley's right, and we are moving inevitably through the unconscious towards a new era of spiritual revolution. It may be that we are in the final phases of man's sad sojourn on the planet. I don't know. I'm definitely for the spiritual revolution. When a man's got nothing, he better grab what's there. You know, I think spiritual revolution is a phrase that keeps coming back to me. It was Crowley's phrase. He said, we need revolution at the root of life. And so that's why sex was so important to him, because he recognized that sex wasn't just a sort of an adjunct to life. Its true magical power is not being expressed. I mean, I only have to think of the sort of porn plethora we have today of this sort of bodies doing things, but they're not getting anywhere.
You're right, and I think in the popular media, and not just with pornography, but with the normalization of the earlier and earlier sexualization of people, and how people are now coming to associate sex with something purely physical and sex for sex's sake. And I think particularly since kind of the 1970s, but it's been ramped up in this century and this decade through popular culture, in particular the music industry and Hollywood and that kind of thing. And I think Crowley's take on sex was very, very interesting, because he saw it as something far more, as you've alluded to there, than purely two people seeking physical gratification. And it was part of this magical aspiration that he had, wasn't it?
Yeah, I mean, the new book, The Beast in Berlin, is absolutely full of this. He was 54, 55 when this was going on. He was in Berlin in the early 30s, in the most sexually liberated cosmopolis, as I call it, in the world. And you get a glimpse there of what this sexual revolution might have to offer in his personal behavior and in his love affairs and relationships with a whole string of rather remarkable ladies who were attracted to him hugely, even though he was physically not at his youthful best. He was quite portly, lost a lot of hair. But they found something about him irresistible. Mm. And, you know, you read about the summer of 1931, it's breathtaking. He's meeting a new girl practically every day. And he had a big relationship with a 19-year-old artist from California, Hannah Jaeger. And that really occupied him. He was mad. They were madly in love and pretty mad with it. It's all in the book. And I describe there also what we mean by sex magic. It is described in the book, the actual technical meaning of what we're talking about here. It isn't sex for physical, for the ego. It's not that. It's an exaltation. Think of it as a sacrament. A sacrament is to take an ordinary thing and raise it to a higher level. And you see that in the Eucharist with the bread and wine raised up to make a link with a heavenly dimension. That's the concept. That's a magical idea. In fact, I've once found a letter from Crowley to the Archbishop of Canterbury asking for clarification on the meaning of the Eucharist. What he wanted was a statement from the Archbishop supporting his idea of the magical sacrament. But, of course, the Bishop wouldn't bite, didn't want to go. Interesting. But so sex for Crowley is a sacrament. It is the offering of the self, the total offering of the self. And to if it was magical, then it was for a specific aim. The child of the encounter was the will, which might be in his case to promote his painting or whatever it was, or to acquire the means to survive, because he was living on next to nothing in Berlin for 2 years. But mind you, a lot of people in Berlin were in the same boat. But he wasn't quite used to levels of poverty, but he coped with it manfully. It's an amazing story. His 2 years in Berlin are an amazing account. It's never been written before and illustrates, I think, the real man, as opposed to this bogey man with the do-as-you-want philosophy crap that people imagine, or some sort of desire to promote evil things and bad. And I will tell you that I spent a long time going through every page of Crowley's surviving letters, diaries, a huge amount of material in the Warburg Institute in London, and never once did I get a feeling that I was encountering a perverse or psychopathic mentality, as you would if you were reading the diaries of a murderer or somebody addicted to crime or sociopathy, or, you know, one of these bizarre, horrible type of people that some people like reading books about. You know, never, ever get an unclean feeling with Crowley. There's always a kind of fabulous and humorous freshness about it. And I don't want to... There are so many things that are still being written about him, which I wrote a complete biography of Crowley, which came out a few years ago. And I thought, well, that scotches all that once and for all. But, you know, they don't want to read it. The reviews in the broadsheets of that book were all repeats of the same litany of Crowley's bad news, Crowley's bad news. And then they'd say something that this book's come out at the end of it. They don't want... It would appear that the mainstream... guardians of opinion don't want to know the truth in this regard. They just don't want it. I have my own theories, you know. I remember John Lennon used to talk about whoever our opposition may be in all their manifest forms. Opposition to spiritual knowledge is always done through others, you know.
Yeah.
God forgives them for they know not what they do. These people who oppose spiritual knowledge and always do, and it seems will, they are themselves dupes, but of course are far too proud to realize it. So, but you know, I'm not going to go all through every, you know, did he mistreat women? Did he do this? Did he do that? Do the other? Read the biography. It's there. You'll find the facts as I found them. And I just, what I found, I delivered. And I checked my stuff and all the rest of it.
So Crowley clearly has very fine aspirations, and they're well documented. He documented them himself. So where did this stereotypical image, I mean, was it purely a manufactured thing? When people accuse him of being a Satanist and being completely evil, I mean, how did that come about, considering the truth of the matter and the fact that he did document his own ideas and thoughts and philosophies every step of the way? Was it a complete cover-up, and how has it been maintained today? Because... we can't, okay,
well,
we can't get away.
Before you go on, I'll have forgotten what your first bit was.
Okay, go with that one.
I think it was an accretion process. It's the rolling, it's a rolling stone that just gathered more moss, if you like. It starts with opposition from religious evangelicals at Cambridge University and then extends to the Order of the Golden Dawn in London. He upset some of those members, not all. Some of them didn't like him. Big personality, bold personality, very sexual personality. He was bisexual, by the way, in case I gave the impression that he was exclusively homosexual. He certainly wasn't. Mostly girls, occasionally a bloke. He produced envy and astonishment, and he didn't watch his back. He was in many ways his own worst enemy. He honestly didn't believe that people would take this Satan stuff seriously. His whole thinking was so attuned to the modern scientific viewpoint that he thought that anybody who, you know, could possibly think of him in Plymouth Brethren terms as the agent of, you know, the horned one, was either stupid or insane. So he didn't really take that. He was interested in the views of the most intelligent people of the culture. He was contemptuous of ordinary things. The newspapers that went against him were all the rags, the daily rags, you know, Daily Express. There was the Looking Glass. These were all cheap rags for people who could only just about read. So he just used to say, oh, you know, of course. But he loved ribbing them at the same time. He loved taking the mick out of the unthinking Christian. He believed that they were on the wrong track, and he didn't mind telling them so. So there was a lot of goading in his work. Yes, he was poking at the beehive. So you could say he asked for it. He was quite happy to sign himself as the Beast 666. But if anyone asked him, said, well, why'd you call yourself the Beast 666? He'd say, well, my mother called me that. She said I was the Beast. And, you know, maybe she caught him, you know, playing with himself or something. That would be the kind of situation which might, you know, generate that comment. But his mother thought he'd been sent to try her. He was her only surviving son. And he didn't go along with the obsessions of her sect. So to her, he was a great challenge. And I think he was very much in the spirit of the satirical spirit of the, you see, in the late 60s. But nobody says Monty Python's satanic, but by God, they're until the Life of Brian film, of course, where, of course, they took the thing head on. And who was the chief backer of that film? Was it not George Harrison, one of the great believers of our times? You know, but the authoritative churches regarded that film as an attack on their control of religious perception, and it was opposed on that basis. But even so, John Cleese was never called the devil, and so on. So Crowley, on the other hand, didn't mind I think he was a little bit in love with the idea of being of what he could do with fame anyway. He thought that maybe being one of the two or three greatest mountaineers of his time, climbed K2, didn't get to the top, but he got the highest anyone ever had on that mountain, spent the longest up on it than anybody had ever held that record at that height on K2. He solitary climb of the Eiger, but this didn't, nothing ever worked for Crowley in a way. Whatever he did, he'd have a terrible run of bad luck, and this went on throughout his life. I think if he was truly the devil's spawn, his life would have been very smooth, and he'd have ended a wealthy and much loved person. You know, his martyrdom is the mark of his seriousness. He really did suffer, poor thing. I mean, he did go. He went through the mill, and all the women who. Many of whom were very intelligent women who got to know him all said, you know, what this man goes through, the world will never realize. But you say, how did it get going? Well, I think it just built up over the years through building up enemies because of the range of his beliefs, because he united sex with religion. And then threw in humor. Oh, my God. Humor, sex, religion.
How dare he?
It was touching every raw nerve of the period. A lot of it today we would maybe not even notice. I don't know. It's hard to say.
A satirical pioneer in a sense.
Oh yeah, a lot of his books were deliberately. So there's one called Why Jesus Wept. You know, and he says in his advertisement he wrote, he says, "Come on, boys, you better read this before the second coming." You know. You better get it now. It could be too late. He may be back next week. You know, He was very good at parodying the tone and style of evangelical tracts of that period. And that wouldn't have made him many friends either. I just think a man like him, who was so much ahead of his time, he was predicting the future, he was prophesying the future, and his prophecies, in my opinion, are almost all spot on. He was a reluctant prophet. He didn't want to be known as a prophet, but he didn't mind being. There were two Crowleys, really. There's the jester who plays with the world, and then there's the serious spiritual giant behind it. And one often is judging the other. And he talked about. He said people did. What did they? He said that so and so has had a vision of the demon Crowley. He knew he had this. People, because they were so struck by him, they would project their unconscious fears onto him. And he could tell when this was happening. He'd say, you know, Norman's had a touch of the demon Crowley, or so-and-so's got the vision of the demon Crowley. People would suddenly develop an enormous fear of him. And he couldn't control that. Sometime it was probably useful to protect him, from constant interference.
Yeah.
But he does, and he still generates that in some people. I think people who've got deep religious or especially sexual religious problems, Crowley is just red rag to that bull, and there's nothing I could write 50 books stating the plain truth. It won't make any difference, you know. Mm. It's like some people couldn't stand Peter Cook, you know. Remember Peter Cook, the wonderful comedian?
Yeah.
Some people just couldn't take it. There was something about him that disturbed people.
Well, I think there's a huge cognitive dissonance that comes into play there, and a collective cognitive dissonance, and people just prefer to avoid any kind of uncomfortable truth then.
Yeah, well, we know that, don't we? And there's the whole thing, the prophet is not without honour except in his own country. Crowley didn't get all this flack when he was in Berlin. He didn't get it where he was taken seriously as an artist and exhibited, the only English artist ever in that period to have his own exhibition in Berlin. And this wasn't something he generated out of his enthusiasm. He was exhibited by Karl Nierendorf and Alfo von Alfensleben, two of the biggest promoters of modern art in Berlin. You know, before the Nazis moved in and called them all degenerates, which in Crowley's case is particularly apposite in the sense that when we see Crowley being his work destroyed as it was, the Gestapo destroyed some of his paintings. When we see Crowley destroyed as a degenerate, we should think how that word, what that word meant in the 1930s, and the fact that in Britain, we obviously regard him as a degenerate in terms of the popular culture, which does that make our popular culture somehow in tune with the repressive powers of fascism? I suspect there's a curious link there. Crowley's play was on the intellect and through the arts of the imagination. And I think it was his dynamism in these areas and the radicalism of his thought that generates this fear. It's still very prevalent in our so-called rational era. You know, I mean, if you want to find out if it exists, do what I've done and write about these things and see the reaction you get. We're still in the dark ages.
Yeah, and it's very interesting because you've mentioned the popular opposition to him, but then...
Well, it's not popular in the sense... I want to say this. He's never had popular opposition. His opposition has never come from the people generally. You know, it's not like people in general don't like Crowley. That's not the case. There were always specific areas of the enemy. The Catholic Church, certain Freemasons, no mm-hmm. question of that, were desperately opposed to him. People in the Theosophical Society were desperately opposed to Crowley, and people who were trying to make a buck out of public morals like Horatio Bottomley and De Wend Fenton. These were two newspaper producers before the First World War. Bottomley was eventually imprisoned for scurrilous activities using his newspaper, and which was one of those patriotic jingoistic John Bull, it was called, and that's what it was full of.
You know? Yeah.
So find out who Crowley's opposition was at the time, and you'll see that people who met him loved him and adored him. When he lived at a cottage in Knockholt in Kent in the 30s, the locals adored him. When he was kicked out of Sicily in 1923 by order of Mussolini, not our friend, I think. Instead of people saying, well, hang on, this was Mussolini that kicked him out. They say, he was kicked out. It just shows what an evil bastard he was. But actually, I found a petition in the Warburg from the villagers of Cefalu, townspeople of Cefalu, petitioning the government to let Crowley stay, as they liked him so much and he was much respected and he'd been a great help to the community.
Yeah, so it's establishment then rather than popular.
Well, certain aspects of the establishment. There were other, you know, no one ever said a bad word about Crowley in the Times, for example. It was always the crap press, you know, go for it. It was his celebrity, of course, there was great jealousy. But I think when they found out that he didn't have the money to defend himself, they went for the jugular. And, you know, that's really what people do. I always, sometimes I feel, I don't like defending Crowley because I think he should be asserted, not defended. Because I think he's one of the greats, you know. He's up there with Blake, Byron, who you like, you know, the poets of the British Isles. We haven't talked about the Irish connection. Crowley, of course, is an Irish name, and his family had originally come from Ireland, and I think that gave him a feeling that he wasn't totally destroyed by sort of what he called an effete English upper class culture. He still had the rebel in him, you know, and I think that was part of his self-belief and identity. He loved all that Celtic stuff that's now so popular, you know, the mythology and all that. He appreciated what it was really saying, our link to nature as a magical link.
And that's very, very interesting, because I would come across, certainly here living in Ireland, quite a lot of people who would certainly mirror your views on Crowley, and it's to hell with what anybody else might say. And there seems to be a huge interest in him, in particular in Ireland, and I have noticed it over the last couple of years. And it totally ties in with what you're saying there. And another area that I found a lot of love for Crowley is the music industry, popular music. I mean, you look at the Beatles, Jimmy Page, Red Hot Chili Peppers. I mean, they did an album entitled Blood Sugar Sex Magic. It seems to be that pop music, particularly the rock music of the 60s, 70s and the 80s, had an absolute fascination with the work of Crowley. Where did that come from? Is that something that just sprung up organically?
I think you can probably trace it to certain characters, people and environments. I mean, the Rolling Stones, as you probably know, when they started out, they were performing a lot in Richmond.
Yeah.
And they had a lot to do with Richmond. Now, Crowley had lived in Richmond during the Second World War, which was only 20 years before. And a lot of people told stories about Crowley, and they heard about him through that. But probably the key point was the arrival of Kenneth Anger on the scene. Kenneth Anger was a Crowley devotee. He's a filmmaker. You know about Kenneth Anger?
I do indeed, yeah.
He's a filmmaker. And independent filmmaker. He was from California. He came to England first of all in the 50s to make contact with Crowley's authentic friends, like Lady Harris, Frieda Harris, who was an artist, and to meet the other members of the old OTO, Ordo Templi Orientis. And he got to know all sorts of people, and his films were projecting ideas of Crowley. And in the 60s, he came back again. He was a guest at the York House at Forthampton Court, where Crowley's friend Gerald York used to live, an upper-class landowner from Gloucestershire. And Anger turned up and wanted to know as much about Crowley as possible. And he met Mick Jagger in London in the 60s, and Marianne Faithfull. And they became friends of the eccentric Kenneth. And I think Ken inspired them quite a lot. And Jagger did the music for one of Anger's films, Invocation of My Demon Brother, I think 1967. Jagger did the soundtrack for that. And of course, out of that, you've got all that's Their Satanic Majesty's Request. So also, you've got to look at the jazz, rhythm and blues scene, Alexis Corner. Those people in London in the 50s, they knew of Crowley because he'd been part of London in the 30s and 40s, and he'd really got around, and he was known in the clubs, he was known in the pubs, and he had a reputation as a distinctive English sage, you know, and there's nobody like him. You know, if you feel that reality is not exhausted by the poetry of Dylan Thomas, and you haven't got made the magical spiritual connection. There's only one man to, in that period who was within living memory to go to, and that was this extraordinary eccentric Aleister Crowley. And the scenes of the London rock scene in that period, of course, they're all overlapping. I think somebody called it a Freemasonry of guitarists at one point, you know, Jimmy Page, Jeff Beck, you know, Jimi Hendrix and all of that. And of course, and John Lennon was reading books on spirituality when he was a student. He was very into it. Bill Harry told me that. It was his friend at Liverpool College of Art. Lennon was very much open to the Crowley thing. I think in his last interview with Newsweek in 1980, he quotes, "Do what thou willst," and he puts it in his own way. He said, "Do what thou willst, but don't hurt anybody," which is a nice sort of wrapping up of the love is the law, love under will doctrine. And of course, he put Crowley on the cover of Sgt. Pepper, which has excited a lot of people. Lousy photo of Crowley, I think. They always put that horrible one on where he looks like, a character from James Bond, whereas I think James Bond himself actually was modeled partly on Aleister Crowley in his spying activities. So you had the rock scene is the art world. The art world had all these people in it at that time in the 60s and the 50s, people like Lady Harris, Kenneth Anger, and they created circles of interest. And the rock scene in the 60s was a bit of a rock aristocracy. You know, they met at the St. James's at the right clubs. There had always been an upper class interest in Crowley right from before the First World War, when he arranged probably the first sound and light psychedelic show ever known, which was called The Rites of Eleusis. I mean, I think he was ahead of Pink Floyd there by 30, 40, 50 years. You know, it's so. That was in 1912. He put on 12 shows with dance and music, where there was a potion passed round. It might have had a bit of laudanum in it or something. And people were invited to join the trip. And this granny took that trip in 1912. There are wonderful stories in Crowley's diaries of them getting very high on small amounts of hashish, which they were burning in the flat in Victoria. And this is 1910. And the description is very much like Mary Poppins, you know. Tea parties on the ceiling.
Yeah,
I love to laugh, all of that. And you think of the dancing on the roof. There's a bit of that there. Mary Travers, who wrote the Poppins books, of course, was inspired by Gurdjieff. But Gurdjieff, Crowley, there is an overlap in theory and belief. So Crowley was. Gurdjieff has become respectable. Crowley still isn't respectable. And that's the other point to what I want to say in answer to your question about the 60s. Crowley wasn't respectable. That makes him a counterculture hero in itself. Crowley wrote at one point, "You can be either respected or you can be respectable, but you cannot be both." And that chimes in with a lot of youthful suspicions of the nature of the world. You can be respected or you can be respectable, but you can't be both. Crowley wanted to be respected, and he didn't give a damn about being respectable. Yeah. And that willingness to live to the full, of course, captured the imagination of the intelligent and sensitive youth of that period, as it will today when people get to hear about it, you know. But we haven't had one decent movie about Crowley, not one decent movie, not one decent documentary about Crowley. They've all been sensationalist, misleading tripe. And I've wanted to make a film on Crowley for years, but do they want a film about the real Crowley? No. They want a film that's Sunday newspaper. They don't want, you know, we're having this conversation. Why, with great respect, this should have been on Radio 4, you know, BBC. It's like you're allowed to have your niche circles, but otherwise you're going to tread on toes. So rock and roll used to be, and for many still is, the dream of a countercultural spiritual urgency about being alive, celebrating life and reality. And Crowley chimes right. He wouldn't have liked the hippies in the sense of the lack of discipline, slovenliness. He was a stickler for appearances, you know, manicures, presentability. But he was terribly eccentric in dress. I mean, when he was wandering around Berlin, he got an orange knickerbocker suit. I'd love to have seen that.
Delightful, yeah.
And he had wonderful selection of hats he would wear at different occasions. Very much like If you think of Salvador Dali, perhaps, or Orson Welles, that's the level of artistic, delightful eccentricity. There was nothing dark about his appearance at all. He was extremely. He wore great ties and cravats and loved colourful, rich colours, as you see in his paintings, which are proto-psychedelic. I don't think I'm completely out of time to say that psychedelic means soul expanding. Soul enlarging, and he was definitely psychedelic.
That's something I wanted to speak about, because his dress sense and his art certainly was psychedelic before its time. And he was a big influence on, I suppose you'd call him a psychedelic guru or whatever, Timothy Leary. And I mean, he openly spoke about the inspiration of Aleister Crowley. What can you tell us about that?
About Leary?
About Leary and some of the other names from the psychedelic era. I mean, we've already touched on some of the musical side of it, but people who were, for the first time, again in the 60s and 70s, who were talking about openly experimenting with psychedelics and drug use and that kind of thing. I mean, Crowley's name comes up again and again when
people speak about influences.
He
should come up again and again, because he was a pioneer in the experimentation and analysis of psychedelic agents. He's one of the very first people to take what was then called anhelonium lewinii, now better known as peyote, and use it experimentally as part of rituals. And he would very carefully write up the results of his experiments in scientific manner. And so he was having complete psychedelic trips in Venice in 1910, and I think he was very interested in the effects of hashish, and wrote a notable, I think 1905, if I remember right, The Psychology of Hashish, one of the earliest texts analyzing the states of mind that can be induced through these then perfectly legal apothecaries' products. He used to get his stuff from Winnerays, the chemist in Piccadilly. So for him, it was about experimentation. He always used very small doses. He wasn't binging, as people sadly are prone to do today. And he saw these substances as related to the old science of magic, which was, do these substances enable people to know their minds better? Well, very different to the idea today. Like, oh, I lost my mind. You know, I was out of my mind.
Complete opposite.
Crowley was never out of his mind. He was always into it. I was thinking of a comment that William Blake's wife, Catherine, once said to a visitor who said, you know, how do you get on with your husband? And she said, well, I don't actually see it. I never see him. He's always in paradise. And Crowley spent a lot of time in paradise. Sadly, a lot of his experimental notes were destroyed by English customs in 1920s. Absolutely appallingly. They just, oh, Crowley, yes, he's the one we've read about in the paper, and they destroyed his books and notes. So he'd spent ages doing deep experiments with psychedelic agents. Of course, he would have been interested in lysergic acid, but I think having taken peyote, he had no need for that. He didn't miss out anything, I think, in the internal sense. Now, the other question was something about who were the sort of psychedelic period in the 60s and Timothy Leary and all that. Now, how did Timothy Leary get to hear about Crowley? I would have presumed it was from the Pasadena Lodge, the Agape Lodge, which was established by a small group of Californians in the 1930s, and which became a kind of radix for Crowley's ideas on a very, very, very small scale. And it was actually run by an Englishman who'd gone over there. He was one of Crowley's first disciples, to use that word in inverted commas, I think, because they weren't slavish people. And they founded a lodge, which really meant they met in somebody's house upstairs, and they built a little temple. And they were investigated by the FBI in the 40s, because a local do-gooder had said there's a sort of cadre of subversives operating on, was it Winona Boulevard? I forget. I think it was Winona Boulevard, Pasadena. And the FBI came along, searched the place, and said, oh, it's a love cult, which when Crowley heard about, he hated the very notion of a love cult. for him, that he thought that they weren't getting it right, if anyone could even get that impression. But of course, where Crowley was around, people did start to feel sexually free. There's a great story about John Lennon being on a tram in San Francisco in the 70s, that just him sitting there, I think he was with Harry Nilsson at the time, just him sitting there, people on the bus started snogging and caressing each other. That his actual presence gave people license to overcome or ignore any inhibition. I think Crowley had that effect on some people as well. You know, just, yes, go on, you can, it's all right.
Yeah, and for those that might laugh at that idea, I mean, just think to your own lives.
That's because they haven't experienced it.
Exactly, and so many people have so many unexplained effects on others. It doesn't have to be sexual, but I mean, just take charisma or stage presence in the arts. Somebody can go up on stage and they just have this magical power over an audience, and there is no reason in the world why that can't be translated in a sexual sense. It doesn't have to be on a stage, and I think that's a very, very interesting point that you've raised there, because that is absolutely entirely possible, and it's something worth exploring, I think.
Yes, it's what the in Hinduism is called the Jivanmukta, is a liberated spirit, and as Gerald York wrote very convincingly, and I also got from his son John when we met, Crowley was in to meet him was to meet a Jivanmukta. It was a liberated spirit, and was a liberating experience, and people who had to put up with it, some of his personal eccentricities and annoyances over the years, those that stuck with him did so because they were getting this liberty spirit. And by that I don't mean the spirit of libertinism, I mean a divine spirit of can do, can see. The world is a bigger place. Crowley used to say, always fun where, never dull where Crowley is. Never dull where Crowley is. I'd like him to be remembered in people's minds in that way. A person who wasn't dull and that literally lit up rooms and lit up lives. And the only people who were offended by him were people who were offended by everything. You know, they're always offended by anybody who speaks their mind or anyone who sings a song or brings music into life. You know, the inwardly repressed, because they themselves are repressed or have been so, of course, are nervous in the presence of such a being. But such beings make life worthwhile. You know, that's what makes life interesting. But there are always plenty of people for whom life would be much better lived in a most uninteresting way. You know, and we are talking life, art, culture. We're talking about being alive. That's what we're all trying to make the most of, I hope, or should be. And Crowley was a person who was trying to make us more alive. That was the game. And to do that, you've got to go to the barricades, you know. The barricades of the mind I'm talking about, not the petrol bombing ones, which end up just creating a bigger mess than you started with.
So it seems like Crowley had a marvellous capacity to unlearn that which we should unlearn. And I think this applies certainly to today more so. And he was quite prophetic in that he spoke about the machine and where things were headed. And I mean, we are living in that. To him, it would have been a dystopian society. And to a lot of people, it is now. But that's exactly where we are now.
Yeah,
so he was quite prophetic in that sense. What were his views, Toby, on death or life after death, or what happens to us when we leave this earth then? Because that's not something that's all that well documented. People just tend to get too caught up in the satanic side of it.
Yes, the activation of the hidden god in man is what we're talking about when we talk about the daimon in the Socratic sense. Socrates, daimon is the also the Pythagorean non-ego, that part of that root of the human being that is not confined and overwhelmed by space and time. It's the activation of that reality that is the aim of all this, is what we're actually talking about. I say that because originally, of course, Satan, the image, had a positive conception of a bringer of light, Lucifer. And only through church teaching did this get amplified into he becomes Ahriman, the principle of evil. But these were all developments of rival priests fighting it out over the meaning of whose temple was going to be the most successful.
the politics of belief.
Yeah, but the what was the other question that you were saying? Yeah, you want about life at, yes,
yeah,
life after death. Well, Crowley didn't have dogmatic views on this subject. He obviously didn't subscribe to the sentimental view that we're going to heavenly green fields, harps, and all that stuff. He was very impressed by the reincarnation doctrine, which he saw in his many travels around India in the first few years of the 20th century, where he lived very close to the earth. He even played the part of a yogi at one point. He went into the temples, made sacrifices, found himself at ease in the Hindu culture, from which he learnt and understood and wrote a great deal. So for him, reincarnation was the way he understood that the essence of being is transmitted through time. But he, as I say, when he was asked specifically on this, he said, you come to your own conclusions. I don't know. He didn't claim to have an authoritative knowledge, only that in his own experience, it seemed to him most likely that whatever he really was would seek a new vehicle to carry on the good work. Now, on that basis, you could say Crowley is almost certainly still with us, you know?
Yeah.
But how would one know? Now, people who've thought they were reincarnations of Crowley tend to have mental problems. And I'd have thought that that would be one of the reasons why perhaps we don't remember previous lives.
Yeah.
We find it very difficult to live the one we're living if we remembered all the ones we had before.
Mm-hmm.
You know, memory almost full, as Paul McCartney said. You know, it would be hard to pin down Crowley on the subject of life after death. He believed in spiritual life, and spiritual life was eternal. But as for the individual, as we know them, he knew that the ego is the obstruction to all progress. The idea of the self, when we talk about a selfish person, somebody who is overwhelmed by their self, you know, the kind of person so overbearingly themselves, but they're not themselves. It's the image of themselves which has taken over.
Yeah.
It's that they worship. Now, Crowley said that you will never get anywhere in spiritual development until you have dealt with the ego. Now, he would say annihilate the ego, which is an Indian way of putting it, and very much in the Buddhist sense. I personally think that's dangerous language to put before Western people, for whom the experience of the self is not a dream. It's a very concrete experience for us. I think if you were brought up in a Hindu culture, Buddhist culture, they have a different conception of themselves in reality. The Western person, to survive anyway, needs to, Brian Wilson, hang on to your ego. But you must learn to deal with this ego and see it for what it is, this image of yourself. That is surely going to die, which is why we grip onto it so cunningly, so constantly. We hold on to our ego because it is a fatal, it is a mortal phenomenon.
Mm.
But the ego is not the holy guardian angel. The ego is not the same as that spiritual power which a person can become aware of, which transcends the self. Now, don't all rush off and try to transcend yourselves. I've been on that road since I was consciously on that road since I was a teenager, and it isn't something you're going to overcome because you had a particularly profound meditational experience, or even a drug experience, or you just walked the hills and suddenly left your body or something.
Yeah.
Dealing with ego is a lifetime job. One might like the idea that when you come to the end of hopefully a long and fulfilling existence, fulfilling anyway, that you'd be happy to leave the ego. Crowley used to be sick. He used to refer in his diaries to AC this and AC that, AC Aleister Crowley. And he had this idea of himself as somebody who was, he was sick of. He'd get sick of Aleister Crowley.
And, yeah.
You know? I mean, that's why we like meeting new people, isn't it? Because we get too sick of ourselves.
Well, I think that's exactly it, the nail on the head. And I mean, a lot of people go mad if they spend too much time with themselves.
Yes, yes. That's because they're mad. But no, it's a valid teaching. We need to look at this ego thing, and especially in the current so-called celebrity nonsense, this constant worshipping of little images.
Mm.
It's pathetic. you know, these little selves dotted around. Here, they look at me. I'm A-list. Are you? I think you're a listless twit, but never mind. Why don't you find out who you really are? You don't need to be celebrated. And anyway, you're not. You're kidding yourself. We don't celebrate celebrities at all. We crucify them. They're there for our entertainment and our amusement. Don't turn yourself into somebody else's toy. And that's what a lot of young people, my daughter's generation, they are seeing so many of these images and this horrible use of the word icon all the time.
Yeah, yeah.
He's iconic. No, he's not. An icon is a Greek word, and it means a painting or image which is a door to God. These aren't icons. Anything very, very far from it.
To be honest, they're the antithesis of anything iconic.
Course, as most truthful things turn out to be. Andy Warhol, when he turned Elizabeth Taylor and Marilyn Monroe into icons, he used to attend a Greek Orthodox church, and he got this idea that America worshipped her stars to the extent that in a more mature culture was reserved for saints. And that was the origin of the iconic irony of the icon in Warhol, which has been totally misunderstood, because the sheep have simply, yes, they have yet again mistaken the icon for the image. Mm. And this is Crowley would have a lot to say about this, of that I'm sure. There are very few icons in the world, and just because something is known and repeat, and this image is repeated across the internet, doesn't make it iconic. It simply makes it repetitive, which ultimately must lead to boredom, and the end of boredom is always despair. So let's leave all that alone.
Yeah, I think that's a very important distinction, because that is the area where the lines get blurred generally.
Oh, Satan never sleeps. The latest, there's always a new thing, the latest misunderstanding, which of course now goes viral, and one man's heresy becomes an international disease. You know, whether it's Koreans dancing in peculiar ways or whatever it is, nonsense. But luckily, these things are very superficial, but you can suffer from saturation.
Developing legacy then, because it is a developing legacy, I think, when we refer to Crowley. It's not just a case of...
Do you really think so? I rather hope so, but I'm not entirely sure.
Well, I certainly do. I think that we referred to the machine a couple of times there, and I think the machine has become more and more overt, particularly in a post 9/11 world. And there are a lot of people, I don't like the word awakening, but there are a lot of people who are, I suppose, developing to a certain extent with regard to their own spirituality, and their eyes are opening to what's going on in a material sense and with regard to the control structure and the machinery and that dystopian narrative, I suppose, that Crowley kind of alluded to or prophetically spoke about. And I think as more and more people become aware of it, and particularly the youth of today, and I'm encouraged by that, because while on one hand we do have this the iconic imagery and the farcical celebration of celebrity culture, we also have a subculture emerging which I don't think has been allowed to emerge in the past quite as readily, and I credit the internet with this and the access to alternative viewpoints and information, that means that people are able to look a little bit deeper and far more easily into what exactly it is that they care to look at. So let's take Crowley as an example there. While in the past, people would only have been exposed to him through whatever books were out there, and a lot of people didn't read, and a lot of people continue not to read.
You couldn't get Crowley books. People literally would not stock them for fear of evil. That is a fact. When I was a young teenager, there was only one or two shops in London that you could find a Crowley book, and in my local library, that even the biography of Crowley had a warning from the library on it that it was not to be taken out by anyone under 21 years old. Now that was only in 1970s,
and that says it all, really. I mean, look at how much it's changed. For example, we can type in Aleister Crowley into Google or Amazon or whatever it might be, look at the amount of crap. But then, of course, look at the amount of stuff that's emerging, such as the work that you're doing, that is the polar opposite of that. And I think people are learning to disseminate. I mean, when the internet first became popular, I think there was, everybody had a tendency to believe absolutely everything, but there's a necessity to be able to disseminate information now, and people are getting a little bit better at that, or I hope they are anyway. Maybe it's the optimist in me speaking, but I really do believe that a legacy, or anybody's legacy now, can change. So you might have had somebody, I don't know, back in the first century BC, and it was set in stone, this is the legacy. That can all change now because of ready access to information. And because Crowley has been such a fascinating figure for the last 100 years, I really believe that his legacy is something that has become almost organic in a sense. And I do think if we had this conversation again in 10 years' time, we'd be speaking about an entirely different legacy to people who might have spoken about him in the 1960s.
I think that's very encouraging to hear you say that. I wish we need to repeat you. We need to get you duplicated because I want to hit that is a very exciting thought. I've had it myself. There's a very unbelievably positive and indeed magical side to the internet, which I excites me. I'd almost wish I was 16 and starting new, because my daughter seems to have total facility with anything electronic. It's like she was born to do it. It's bizarre.
Yeah.
Whereas for me, you know, it's, oh God, it's another thing I've got to learn, you know. But one thing I will say, and I want to say, is that you will never over, this is wonderful, but never forget the book. The book is vital. If you don't read, your mind doesn't get real exercise.
I couldn't agree more.
A lot of the internet is distraction. And it's also not good for your eyes to constantly read stuff on an electronic screen, however it's illuminated. Books are the holders of wisdom, and always will be. And they've never come up with a better format. It's easy to hold, get through, flick pages, etc., etc. So I hope our wonderment at the technology doesn't blind us to the importance of feeding your mind with good books, well, beautifully written things.
Absolutely. Yeah. Plus, a solar flare isn't going to wipe out a library.
That's a very good point, isn't it? Well, you know, I mean, yes, you think of the Library of Alexandria being burnt down by Christian fanatics, if you remember the history. And what we lost, totally and utterly irreplaceable. More and more I've become more aware. I always believed strongly in books, but now with the internet, as an adjunct to reading, the internet is matchless. It's phenomenal. It's astonishing. It's all happened so very, 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 very quickly. And you're right, it is producing a new kind of culture. And you talk about legacy. I think you're right. I think the legacy of Crowley, he knew would not come in his lifetime. He wanted it to. Of course he did. Anybody would want recognition and understanding in your lifetime. It's miserable and lonely to be ignored. But he knew that he said, you know, all the things that have happened to me will testify on my behalf in the times to come, when people are not afraid to look into the facts of it. I think that time has come, or is coming. Certainly, as you say, there's been a big difference since the 60s. I mean, I almost got sent down from Oxford because I'd done a drawing of Crowley, quite a good one, I thought, which I put on my door, and was greeted as though Satan had taken up residence, you know. And there was a move to sort of get me out, you know. There was because again, it was the Christian Union, the theological aspect of the college, which was very sensitive to this.
Yeah,
nobody else either didn't care or were quite interested in the subject. I think people are, you know, given chance and choice.
I think people really are, and
I think what you're talking about Ireland's very interesting, because in Ireland, you know, the power of the priesthood is on the wane, and this has all kinds of potentials for you know, change and enlightenment and all the rest of it.
Well, definitely, because it's almost like that spiritual block that was enforced by the Catholic Church in Ireland has left people with a freeness of spirituality that they are looking for something else to fill with, and they're far more open to exploring new ideas and new concepts, and I think that's a positive thing ultimately.
I think it is, and people are free now to choose and to explore, which is very good. You could say, I mean, I'm sure a spokesman of the Vatican say, well, this, yes, but all that's going to happen is they're going to get misled into this Gnostic stuff, and they're going to end up, out of their minds, mental hospital, you know, all the horror stories, you know, the demons will get you if you leave the fold.
Yeah.
You know? Well, maybe the demons are in the fold. You know, and for the sake of your health of mind, you need to get out. And it's a liberation. Of course, in all spiritual adventuring, there are risks, and that has always been the case. But not if you hold fast to the truth, and the best, your ideals. You know, if you stay with what you know to be right in your deepest self, then you won't go far wrong. You may have some interesting adventures. And what's life? What is life but should be an interesting adventure? It can't. What's the point of being born if it's not an adventure?
Well, exactly.
It is anyway.
I mean, it's about exploration. It's about discovering secrets, as you mentioned there, and only then can we develop and have a good time.
Well, yes, pleasure is the sort of the byproduct of doing the right thing.
I agree. You know, I agree.
I always loved what Crowley said. He says, "A yogi gets more pleasure from moving his leg than a millionaire from a week in New York."
I'd like to put that one to the test, but it's a very fine quote. Yeah. I'd like to experience both sides there.
Well, yoga means union. So if we're talking about a true yogi, is he's in union with God. Mm. Now, if you were in union with God, I should think everything that happened to you would be of a pleasure far exceeding what a millionaire can get out of New York with the largest expense account.
Exactly. I think that refers back then to us transcending ourselves, or certainly transcending our material selves.
Yes, yes. We've got, I think culturally we've got to, I think the human race has reached the absolute, you know, the vanishing point of materialism. It was always a fiction, but I mean, the only thing that's going to end this insane fundamentalism is a real spiritual awakening, because that is really the gap that all these things are trying to fill.
I think it's the perfect time, Tobias, to mention your books. There are many of them. The current one, of course, is The Beast in Berlin, and that's why we're talking about Aleister Crowley. How can people get their hands on your books? Because you've written so extensively, and I think there is a lot of information. I haven't read them all yet, but there's a lot of information that's extremely valuable to people, certainly in the context of what we've been speaking about.
Yeah, I wanted to, I don't know if I wanted to begin with. I appear to have produced a kind of encyclopedia gnostica.
Yeah.
I always wanted to cover all the main features of spiritual philosophy and history and get it right. And in a straight and honest and informed and hopefully stylish way.
Yeah.
I mean, I wrote poetry before I wrote prose, and I think that is what real writing is about. So it's the quality of the writing, I hope, matches the grandeur of the material. I think I've covered most of the areas, although my new one I'm writing at the moment hones in on aspects that I haven't looked at so closely before. You get them, obviously. You can get them in through bookshops or on Amazon. Just dial Tobias Churton, or my website has a fair amount of information, tobiaschurton.com. Or you may have a friend who's, you know, and all that. You know, they're not that difficult. You don't have to dig them up. Yeah. But I think that's, again, you were talking about the internet. You've got to look in a way. You won't find my books in Smith's.
Right.
Do you have Smiths in Ireland? W.H. Smith, do they operate over there?
No, but most Irish people would be very familiar with Smiths. Yeah,
W.H. They're not in Smiths, although I've seen a fair number in the bigger Waterstones bookshops. And I've been dealing a lot recently with American publishers, and American publishers don't even notice the UK particularly.
Yeah.
So, you know, I have no trouble getting my books in Florida. I did a wonderful book on John the Baptist a few years ago called The Mysteries of John the Baptist. And that you can't get it in this country, but you could certainly get it through Amazon. No problem whatsoever. But not everyone likes buying on Amazon. And I don't think the publishing trade's realized that yet. There are still people who like to browse in bookshops. And actually pay what the book is worth.
No, I think so. And from my own point of view, while I buy plenty of books on Amazon and online, there is nothing quite like losing yourself for an afternoon in a bookshop, just being surrounded by the physical material. Like, I'm not a big shopper. I don't like shopping. I hate shops, actually, in high street stores. But when it comes to bookshops, you can leave me there all day, every day, and I'll be happy.
It's a joy for me to hear.
Well, hopefully more people experience the same. I suppose to summarize, and I'm going to put you completely on the spot, Toby, and I'm going to ask you to sum up the life and work of Aleister Crowley in one sentence, if you can, or one phrase even.
Crowley, a man fascinated by the mystery of life, with the courage and intellect to enter into that fascination fully.
I have the power, you have the power, we have the power. Tobias Churton, it's been a great pleasure speaking to you on Alchemy, and thank you for joining me. I look forward to our next conversation.
Do what thou wilt, shall be the whole of the law.
Alchemy.